This is a story about returning to a place never visited. A story about escaping, discovering, and re-encountering. A trip in search of impossible memories. It is, above all, an African story, the geography of eternally missing peoples.
My name is Hamidu Omar. I am 40 years old and I am of Peul origin. I was born in Mauritania. The Peul have traditionally been nomadic shepherds that are found throughout Western Africa. My parents had already settled down when I was born, but they told me about some Peul people in Niger and who have always maintained our culture alive. They are known as the Uodabe people. I once saw an Uodabe woman who visited my home. Since then, I've dreamed about coming to Niger in order to get to know them. Some years ago, I emigrated to Spain, where I currently live. I have done well for myself, thus making my dream come true.
If there was a place in Africa to flee from, it would be from the cities. But Niamey is the exception, but not because it is a beautiful or pleasant city. What sub-Saharan African capital deserves enjoying adjectives like those? Niamey's charm lies in its image as a rural capital. No one has immigrated from the country to the city, but instead, they have taken the country to the city. No more than 5% of the total population lives in Niamey, and the remaining 20% of the people are nomadic. But this does not mean that the city does not have modern buildings. The exploitation of uranium during the 1970s provoked building fever, which resulted in the construction of banks and ministries with a dubious architectonic taste, which modernity has allotted these places. Uranium became outdated in the West in the 1980s, and consequently, this building impulse abruptly stopped.
When I made the decision to emigrate to Europe, I promised myself that someday I would return to Africa, but as a tourist. When I was young, I saw how white people came to my country for tourism, and I never understood what was so interesting about going around a place without really doing anything. Now, since I work 14 hours a day, I understand what they were doing. It makes you feel that you are free, although it only lasts just a few weeks.
My name is Mama Munde. I am 34 years old. I have three wives and 13 children. I am in Uodabe Peul from Niger. Two of my wives, my brothers and sisters, and also my parents live in the countryside with the animals. I spend part of the year living a nomadic life with my family, and the rest of the time here in Niamey, where I run the Nomadic Shepherds Association of Niger. In Chintaparaden, which is where my family lives, I have some cows, sheep, donkeys, and a number of camels. I like to stay here in the city, but I also miss the country, especially now during the rainy season, when great celebrations take place.
Your uncle Ahmed gave this letter to me in Nouakchott. He cannot come to the feast this year, but he sends his best wishes to you.
Thank you. Thank you. We already knew you were coming and are very happy. In the country, everyone is waiting for you. It's going to be a great feast, the best in years. This year it has rained a lot, more than ever. Crops have been good, and the animals have given very good milk. My own cows have given birth to half a dozen calves. You are coming to the countryside at the best time of the year. I'm very happy that you've come.
What wonderful news. I look forward to starting our trip.
Me too. We'll leave in a couple of days. I must go to the market to pick up some clothes for the feast. And I also want you to see my house in Niamey. After that, we'll go to the country.
In Niamey, modernity is made up of islands that transform it into something somewhat less than a city, but somewhat more than a dusty village. The dirt roads, with some asphalt, are shared equally by cars, goats, men, and camels alike. From the Kennedy Bridge, you often can see groups of camels that get lost as they head for the city center. The devastating drought during the 1980s hit Niger like no other country in the area, killing more than half of the livestock and plunging it into an economic crisis from which it is still not recovered. For the first time in history, the Niger River stopped flowing through Niamey. A river that strongly flows today disappeared as if it was never going to return again. Life takes place in the street. They sleep, chat, and even eat in the street. There's no space for private life in Africa. And in that aspect, Niamey is one of the most African capitals of the continent. Mama and Hamidu had never met before. Their only connection is through Mama's uncle, who years ago emigrated to Mauritania, where he met Hamidu's family. But their language and origins also link them. Nowadays, there are about 6 million Peul people distributed throughout Western Africa, but only about 40,000 Wodabe keep the nomadic tradition alive and almost unchanged, as well as their cultural universe that has distinguished them for 4,000 years. In the Tassili cave paintings located in Algeria, you can see the Sahara Desert covered by grass and nomadic shepherd tribes taking care of their livestock. The men have long bodies, long braided hair, and the cows that they cared for were of Zebu origin. The men in the drawings were Peul Uodabi people, like Mama and Hamidu. These are the same men who, even today, continue to undergo the seasonal migration through the Sahel in Niger, or those who emigrate to Europe to earn a living. Only one of Mama's three wives, Haiba, lives with him in Niamey. Haiba is the last and youngest of his wives. He has had three children with her, who also live in Niamey. In spite of the austere and rural aspect of the house, it is situated in the heart of the city center, just about 10 minutes walking distance from the market where Mama has just bought a new tunic. It is the neighborhood where the Uadabi people who have a house in Niamey reside. Here, they reproduce their country lifestyle, but in the city.
Look, here I am at the Gerewol celebration. That's how we dress for the feast. You'll see.
Was this picture taken in Chintabara then?
Yes, yes, in Chintabara then. These are my wives. And this is an old picture with one of my brothers. Look, we wear this on our heads during the feast. Let's have some tea.
The rest of Mama's family lives in the north of the country, between Tagwa and Agadez, in the grass border preceding the desert. During the dry season, they move their camps from well to well, searching for water and fresh grass to feed their animals. When the rains come, if they have been abundant, they move less, and life becomes somewhat languid and peaceful. But with or without rain, the work of the women in the camp never stops. According to the Uadabi's distribution of work, women are responsible for everything that occurs inside the camp, while the men take care of what happens outside the camp. For the women, it's a case of true bad luck, since everything that occurs tends to take place within the campsite. They cook, take care of the children, milk the animals, and cut firewood. Outside the camp, the livestock graze. In this season, livestock graze alone, and so the men dedicate their time to taking care of their physiques. If anything is typical of the Uadabi people, it is their obsession with masculine beauty. During the dry season, when water is scarce and it is necessary to travel far in order to find some, things become balanced. Women do not work less, but the men work a little more. Tamaril is Mama's first wife. They have five children. Their respective parents set up their marriage. The first wife is always an agreement made among families of the same lineage as an aim to keep the family united. Since birth, some girls are already chosen for a cousin or even an uncle by means of a ritual that lasts for years and is not completed until the birth of the first child. Lame is Mama's second wife. They also have five children. Second and third wives are chosen freely, and usually for sentimental reasons. Another marriage possibility is one that allows widows, if they wish, to join with their children the family of one of the deceased's brothers. The exchange of cows is the common currency for all these unions. The three options described, and the possibility of condemnation on both parts, motivate a continuous coming and going of men, women, and cows that finally comes to order with a marriage feast that takes place once the rainy season arrives. Asi is Mama's niece. She is engaged to Buna, who is one of the most charming boys, or so they say, in the Gerewol dance. The feast is about to begin, and during the previous week, the young boys will put on makeup and dance for the girls. Hasi has been lucky. Her union is not an obligation, but a voluntary one. If everything goes right, they will be officially married once the feast is over. Adama is Hasi's grandmother and Mama's mother. She is 67 years old, a very advanced age for Uodabi women, who rarely live more than 55 years. She is very happy about her granddaughter's future wedding. The bus station of Niamey is the most important place in the city. It is the meeting point for those who come from the desert and those traveling to the south. A place to unload merchandise and where you will find men moving in all directions. Today, the bus stations in Africa fulfill the same functions as the old stations during the time when the caravans still traveled. Mama and Hamidu will go to the north. It is a long journey to the camp of Mama's family. The bus that leaves from Niamey takes 15 hours to reach Tagwa. There, they will take another vehicle until they reach an intersection where an asphalt road appears. From there on, only trucks enter from time to time, carrying merchandise to the village of Chintabaraden. Chintabaraden is the center of the world, at least for hundreds of Uodabi families just like Mama's, who live a nomadic life. It is not a large village, but on market days you will see lots of Uodabi people who leave their camps to buy, sell, or just to look around. But not only Uodabi people visit Chintabaraden. They share territory with the Tuaregs. The real region of the Tuareg people is located closer to the north, towards Agadez. But after the war that they fought against the Niger government from 1991 to the year 2000, they were obliged to take refuge far from their territory. We could say that this is their southern frontier. In fact, it was here where the war started, the place chosen by the rebels to execute their first hostile actions against the Niger army. Chintabaraden has only one long street with two shops that sell Coca-Cola and stalls where the nomadic people can buy some small items. The days prior to the feast, the village looks wonderful. The Uodabi go to the market to buy things to decorate their clothes. They sell the unproductive cows or goats and buy bracelets, bird feathers, strings for necklaces, and colored fabrics. The Uodabi have never been craftsmen. The nomadic way of life is incompatible with the tranquility that craftsmanship requires. They buy or barter for everything they may need at the market, that is, every cloth or any object for their day-to-day lives. Mama and his colleagues in the association are trying to change this situation. They have created some craftsmanship workshops so that they do not need to depend on manufactured objects so much. These workshops are already working in Niamey, and one of the main objectives for their trip is to recruit more members for the association. The road ends in Chintabaraden. From here to the north, a wide space of virgin plains opens up, which is the real home of the men who we see walking around the market. From here on out, Hamidu and Mama will walk their way to where the family's camp is settled.
After leaving Chintabaraden behind, for the first time I feel like I've crossed a frontier. This feeling has nothing to do with lines on a map, but with the perception of invisible limits, of places where something ends and a door opens to the unknown. I feel rather strange walking alongside Mama in the middle of nowhere. It's really something new, but at the same time I feel as if I've always been here.
También el Banco Central deja definitivamente su condición de instituto emisor y lo propio ocurrirá con la Casa de la Moneda. Estamos ya en el tiempo que dedicamos a la cultura, tiempo de Cusa Campillo del Campo. Es una información que elabora nuestra compañera Cusa, como les decimos, nuestra compañera Cusa Campillo del Campo. Voces de Europa cantan hoy en Santiago de Compostela. Se trata de una coral de la que forman parte chicos de 316.
What are you listening to on the radio?
It is the Spanish radio. I can only tune into it at night.
And tell me, Hamidu, what about Spain? What do they think about our people there?
It is really different. In Europe, people think we don't have any food or any culture. They know nothing about Africa. But Africans do not know anything about Europe either. In Spain, there are thousands of Africans that cross the ocean by boat, and upon arrival, they find themselves with no legal papers or work. It's not easy at all to earn your life there. People think they will become rich very quickly, but the truth is that you'll be very lucky if you get a job and a house. I live in Vitoria, northern Spain, and people there respect immigrants. It's not the same in other places of Spain and Europe. You must be very careful when you walk along the streets. Also, you have to be careful not to get angry if someone insults you or treats you like an animal.
After 2 days of walking along the savannah, Hamidu and Mama finally reached the camp. It was not easy to find. Although during the rainy season people move less frequently, it is quite rare that they stay in the same place for more than 2 weeks. As they walk, they have been asking other nomadic people for information about Mama's family's location. The Uodabe are not very warm when it comes to welcoming people. Mama has not seen his family for several months, but nothing indicates that they have been separated for so long. For Hamidu, this is a deep emotional moment. Although he seems quite distant, Mama has been talking about his family these last few days. Lame and Tamaril, his children, his mother. He has expressed how much he wished to see them again. He has talked about them so much that Hamidu could easily recognize them even without previously being introduced. Every time Mama returns from the city, he brings lots of gifts for his wives. Lame likes necklaces and earrings, Tamaril prefers bracelets. His grandmother loves those large pieces of cloth imported from Indonesia or the Philippines.
Look, that one is Chibela. The one over there is Kuri. And this one on the right is Yaya. I have 30 cows and 7 breeding bulls. When I got married for the first time, I just had 5 cows and a bull. Now the family has increased, and as soon as one of my daughters gets married, it will increase even more. In just a few years, my animals will cover this valley. If no drought or epidemic comes about, I will double my cows in just 3 years, and with the money I get from the sales, I'll buy a car. That's why I must learn how to drive.
The fight for survival has traditionally been based upon the clan, the family, and so it continues to be. Everyone owns livestock, and if things go right, the community does not interfere. On the contrary, if a man loses his cattle for any reason, the rest of the tribe will give him some cows and bulls until his herd recovers. Mama's family planned to stay there for a few days, until it was time to travel to the place where the feast was to be celebrated. It was a slightly uneven plain with good grass, big acacias, and ponds where animals could drink. But before leaving the camp, Mama fulfills his promise of killing a goat in honor of his guest. In very few cases do the Odabe kill an animal to eat it. This sacrifice is justified only on very special occasions. Daily food is basically milk and millet. Meat is only eaten during these events. Mama never had problems when choosing a wife. Shortly after his first marriage, he was already considered a good match, one of the best choices within many kilometers around. He was a worldly man living in Niamey, with a lively attitude that made him the most promising male of his clan. When he married his third wife, he had to pay 2 cows for her, which would later become the girl's mother's property. Women are the owners of their cows, except the Sudu women. It's quite surprising that a society that makes women carry out the hardest tasks allows them to own their own tent, their cows, and also have a number of rights. Until they get married, they have absolute sexual freedom, which becomes restricted only after the first son is born. Once married, they lose this sexual freedom, but instead earn the right to divorce their husbands and return to their mother's camp or to another man's camp without suffering any social rejection. Nomadic people own very few things. They could not constantly move from place to place if they had to carry so many useless things. In barely 20 minutes, the women strike the camp. They're accustomed to doing it. The need to search for grass obliges them to move frequently. During the endless 9-month period when the Sahel becomes a dry plain, they change camp locations 2 or 3 times and migrate towards the south. Every family follows pre-established traditional itineraries and joins other families near the wells, which they have been sharing for centuries. Past rains have been good, but the tendency during the last 15 years has been a dramatic decrease of northern flooding. The Uodapi have had to move closer to the agricultural areas as time goes on. Years ago, the land border between the desert and the harvested lands was vast enough to travel without any problems. Now, this border has become very narrow, conflicts have multiplied, and many men are finding the solution to their problems in Niamey. The women mount the camp again at its new location, just as they struck it in the morning. It's the meeting point, a place for seeing the members of Mama's clan. As they have always done when the rainy season ends, the Uodabe people meet again to show that they are still alive.
We haven't seen each other since last year, and this is a very special occasion. It is special because we are together once again, and because Hamidu has come from Europe to meet us. He is a Peul as we are, but he was born in Mauritania. He is a good example for the Uodabe people, since he went to Europe to look for prosperity, and as you can see, has come here by plane, like white people do.
All the men who came together to meet Hamidu were members of Mama's clan. Mama also belongs to one of the 2 high classes in which the Uodabe people are divided. Apart from introducing Hamidu to the attendees, Mama called for this gathering in order to insist on the need to find alternative sources of income.
But the situation could change if you'd come to the city periodically. If you did so, you could earn enough money to buy food and deal with your troubles during the dry season.
For years, Mama has been trying to persuade the young people not to leave the countryside. He has tried to convince them just to take advantage of the opportunities they could find in the city. He has not succeeded. The elders do not support him. They state, with experienced certainty, that the majority of those who leave never come back. Furthermore, not all Uodabe people are like Mama. With the exception of Mama, the Uodabe are shy, reserved, just the opposite of how you must act to succeed in an urban jungle.
Our celebration must be special this year. It must be a great feast. We've had rain. The animals are strong, and Hamidu has come to see us. It's as if everything was in our favor. Let's hope that in the coming years we can have the same reasons to celebrate. Let's hope that we stay together for many years. That's what we want, to remain together so that our animals and children can grow up healthy and happy.
Once the introductions to the community have been made, Mama takes Hamidu to meet Nyalauro, the chief of the clan. This is our history, taking care of cows. When our ancestors were born, they were doing that already. They were looking after the livestock. If it doesn't rain, we cannot feed our animals, which means that there's no milk for us either.
No grain grows. Everything is dry, and there's no possibility for life.
And how do you manage when this happens?
When this happens, we must go far to buy feed for the animals. We wet it and give it to them, but we do not always have enough money to buy it, and so many of our animals die. When the animals die, people also die. That's why some people move to the city. Periods of drought are becoming more and more frequent.
Yes, but for now, your animals and people look healthy, don't they? That means that everything is going well, doesn't it?
That's the miracle of living in the countryside. We can suffer three very bad years and the animals and people die. Then we experience two good years and everything is forgotten. Our grandparents left all these lands and animals to us, and it's our duty to keep them and maintain them. That's what the tradition says, and that's how it's always been. Tradition is the only force that keeps us together.
The Gerewol is a large feast. There are no gods to thank or sins to redeem. It is not an offering to an invisible divinity, but an homage that the Uodabe grant themselves for having withstood the critical problem of another drought period. For 7 days and nights, the most handsome young men in the clan will compete in elegance and congeniality in front of the women of the community. During the feast, they dance, drink, and arrange marriages. It is a celebration to complete the last cycle of the year. Later on, the new couples and the old couples will leave with their livestock to begin the eternal circle of survival once again. The feast starts with the sacrifice of a cow and the ritual of distributing the meat. The meat is divided into 7 lots, from big to small, depending on the rank within the community. Nyalaudo and the rest of the old men of the council will have the biggest portion. Then comes Kayasa, chief of the dance, and his assistants. And finally, the rest of the people, who usually get just a clean bone and some soup. The Uodabe are obsessed with the number 7, for divisions as well as the rest of their activities. And this is not because they believe in 7 principal gods or that the world was created in 7 days. They do not know when the world was created, nor do they even care. They just think about things of this earth. They are neither fond of the soul, nor are they polytheistic. They do not worship their ancestors or believe that there is life after death. They accept the existence of some vague beings which they call the genies of the bush. They protect themselves from their spells by wearing many amulets in their hair or on their clothes. If a woman pierces her ear 7 times, or names her child on the 7th day after birth, it is simply because she likes this number and nothing else. The Uodabe kingdom exists and is alive in this world indeed. They try to suffer and enjoy life without waiting for a reward. They work hard for 9 months and take every drop of water out of the earth. When the rainy season comes, they receive this prize for their determination. The world of the Uodabe people is childish, sensual, and sensitive. A world of naughty glances and elegant grazing. It is a universe of hefty women and effeminate men. Men and women who must face death's menace every winter with the strength of a ship on the ocean. People who look into the eyes of life sweetly, as if there were not even a little bit of perversity to be found in their hearts.
Look, Hamidu, this is Kayasa, the chief of the dance. He is in charge of organizing everything related with the dances. He teaches boys the best way to sing. When boys are 7 years old, all of them go to see him, and he decides who is able to dance and who is not.
Where do the games and dances they perform come from?
They already existed when we were born. Our ancestors knew them. My parents, my grandparents, everybody knew them. I do nothing but repeat what they once did. That is my job, to help the boys become men. The dance is the way to enter the adult world.
The dances start in the evening and last all night long. Starting at midday, the boys put on makeup and get dressed to look handsome for the girls. To be considered beautiful in the world of Yuodabe men, they need to have wide eyebrows, a long nose, and very white teeth and eyes. They shave their foreheads and decorate their faces with makeup and drawings to stylize their features. To accentuate the white in their eyes and teeth, they use dark-colored makeup. Black dust from used radio batteries is their favorite color. All the colors they use are natural, except that one, a brutal modern contribution to makeup used by the Uodabe. The rest of the colors are obtained from crushing and mixing animal tissue and plant dried in the sun with milk or water. Women also put on makeup. They are in some ways the stars of the feast. The reason that the men adorn themselves so carefully is for the women. They show off in front of them, and it is the women who choose a man and walk the first step towards the bushes. Hasi has a special reason to look nice. Buna, her future husband, will be among the dancers. For the Uodabe, there is no other marriage ceremony than that of asking for the girl's hand, the verbal agreement, and the Gerewol. After the feast, they are considered married, but they do not live together until their first son is born. Buna and the rest of the boys are ready. The gowns woven by the women are finished, and compliments are added to the ensemble. The acacia's shadows resemble an improvised dressing room of a big sand theater where a representation of Verdi's Aida is about to start. The Uodabe pretend not to own anything but their sword and fetishes. However, these dressing rooms with the shape of an acacia's branch are full of luxury dresses and ornaments. Where have all those silk cloths, silver clips, ostrich feathers, and seashells come from? The dancing starts with the yake. which in some ways is a warm-up exercise in which the boys make forced facial expressions and move like snakes to show how white their teeth and eyes are. Just three words define the Udabe character: Munyal, Togu, and Bodanyaku. Munyal means patience to resist adversity and later enjoy the good moments. An old Udabe proverb says, "Those who cannot stand the smoke will never reach the fire." Togu means something like a mix of beauty and charm, a seductive power that consists of talking and tuning the voice in a certain way when singing. Bodanyaku means tradition, the set of rules which unite them and also differentiate them from outsiders. It means help and mutual solidarity. This is how it has been up until now. But is this enough, since every 10 years their life becomes harder and the alternative of moving to the city is becoming the only solution? During the feast, the Tuaregs come to visit them. Their relationship is friendly, except in periods when the drought is more severe and they have to compete with them for the wells. This ceremony has nothing to do with religion. It is earthly. Just dance after dance. Then, when night falls, the girls make gestures at the boys, which is their cue to step out of the line and follow them to the bushes. During 7 days, the rhythm of the feast is the same. When the sun rises, men rest under the shadow of an acacia, and women continue to do their daily jobs: milk the cows, crush the millet, suckle the babies, find water. For them, life does not distinguish a workday from a holiday.
There's nothing better than making a dream come true. And if this has been your childhood dream made real, you feel something very similar to what people call happiness. I do not exactly know what happiness is. My father used to say, when he was in Mauritania, that happiness travels incognito, and only when it has passed will we know what it is. But he also said that if you find it and really want to keep it, you must be happy in a low voice.
The Uodabe do not have a concept that explains what being happy means. They suffer. They love passionately, like all human beings. But as a group, they have a strange quality that leads them to understanding. Tolerance. They may argue for hours without raising their voices or making serious decisions. Life goes on without any suspicion or any intention to conquer other people's lives. Mama is the example of a life divided between two worlds, and he lives this way without any kind of schizophrenia, opening a door for others without closing it behind. We can say that Hasi and Buna are already a new couple. Buna considers Mama's proposals and wants to leave for Niamey. He is fed up with the monotony, always seeing the same faces, fed up with drought and troubles suffered during the dry season. Hasi wants to leave as well. For them, Niamey means the hope for a better and idealized future. When they arrive, they may find that an immigrant's dream come true is not what they expected. New suffering, social rejection, and even hunger. Or maybe they just might find, like Hamidu, a better life. Who knows?